This is Ham Radio Now, episode number... Wait, it's not really an episode. I went to Quartzfest over the last couple of days with Jim, NO1PC, and while I was there, I was able to record the ARRL forum, led by Dick Norton N6AA, the Southwest director. And I've followed Dick for a number of years. In fact, I used to be his next-door neighbor. And when I can go to the Hamfest that he speaks at, I try to record and bring those talks to you, the audience. Dick talks a lot about what's going on with the ARRL. There's some good, there's some bad, there's some ugly. And he's sharing openly and honestly about what he thinks and how things are going. So without further ado, I wanted to bring you his talk. And we'll probably talk about it some more on an episode coming up rather soon. In fact, a couple hours. Anyhow, that's it for me. I'm going to turn it over to Dick Norton.
Welcome to the 2023 Quartzfest AR meeting. Here it's a week later and we haven't seen them, but what I'm going to talk about that happened at the meeting are actually related to motions that were passed, and you'll see the exact motions come out in the minutes of the board meeting when those come out, and they'll probably also be referred to in a QST article and something that will come out on the web or the ARRL newsletter very shortly. As I understand it, this presentation is being recorded, so I'm not sure exactly where I should...
Just talk to the group.
It doesn't matter where I stand.
Yep.
Anything you say is likely to make it out on the web at some point. I actually spent quite a bit of time this year planning out what to say, because I have a reputation of kind of being transparent to the point where some people don't like what they hear. And so I've carefully crafted my words and subjects that I'm going to talk about. And the intent is to get across to you actually things that are really going on, and not only whitewash things that people would rather not talk about, but let's make sure everyone understands what's happening. Let's first talk about what happened at the ARRL board meeting, which impacts hams. It's subjects that are related to what the league or the board is attempting to do to service hams, to do something that will impact you. We'll talk a little bit later about things the board does to consider itself. People have said a lot of the board meeting nowadays is about the board itself, and there's a certain amount of truth to that. At the end, after that, we'll talk about radio politics, what's going on in the league, board politics as far as that goes, and at the end, we'll talk about other things the league is doing. Rick Paquette mentioned a good number of them, and at that point, you can bring up anything you'd like, and I'll attempt to respond to it. This is a forum again. At any point you have a question or a comment, please raise your hand. I'll make an attempt to acknowledge you and let your let you voice your opinions to the group here, as well as whoever will observe this forum on the internet. The first thing I'll talk about that the league did with respect to helping hams is something I'm in a reasonably way responsible for, and that's we put $150,000 in this year's budget for the league to support conventions. Now, what does that exactly mean? I had a more detailed program of what to do, but it's roughly $1 per member, and I perceive conventions as being a very important part of ham radio. When we get together, we get to know each other as people. Those who do that end up in leadership positions in clubs, in the ARRL, and contribute. So I'm very in favor and pro having conventions. I see more section managers here than I thought before. But it's an aside. So I'll tell you, as far as I can see, every member of the ARRL board is in support of this. Whatever their politics are otherwise, it was, the support seemed universal. So the ARRL board wants you to know they're concerned with you having conventions, and they'll like to promote it. I'll just go over a couple of details that I thought that are in my mind. They're not in the motion that eventually passed. What got passed was the money got added to the budget, and headquarters is to determine exactly what we do with it and how people apply for it or how it's granted. But my thought was, I really want the money to be used to support conventions that would not otherwise happen. And that's, those of you that know Yuma, that's the classic example. But remember, before Yuma, which has been the division convention for a good number of years, the Southwestern Division Convention would move around Los Angeles, San Diego, Phoenix, Santa Barbara, Riverside, Anaheim, and it rotated around through the sections. And then as the venues became too costly for the hams to have a successful convention at, everything dropped out, and then for the last few years, Yuma was our only the only group that offered to put a convention on, so that's where the division convention was. And then, as you all know, this year they're having a little financial issues, and so it was canceled. Incidentally, I have a meeting with the Yuma Club tomorrow, and I'm going to talk to their chairman of the convention and whatever other members are, and let's see whether we can get something going. As you all heard, Rick Paquette is working other avenues to get conventions possibly started in other parts of Arizona. I'd like to get one back in Los Angeles. I'd like to actually be everywhere, and let's work as the ARRL is going to, I hope, support whatever events can be put together. Now remember, the ARRL historically does not take any financial responsibility for conventions. Other groups do that. What happens after they plan out a convention, they fill out a form that promises to do certain things like have forums or have an ARRL forum, and the ARRL awards it the title of a division convention or a state convention, but the ARRL has never taken any financial responsibility. Somebody else signs contracts with hotels, convention centers, and when they have a loss, they eat it. And that's why the Santa Barbara Club lost a lot of money when they did it the last time. The club around Riverside, San Bernardino, this is over 15 years ago, they, you know, slightly lost money, so they stopped doing it, and same happened in San Diego. This isn't only a problem in Southern California and Arizona. One of the biggest conventions in America was HamCon in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and that has the same problem. It stopped. It was probably the fourth largest convention in America of hams, and it needs help if it can be resurrected. So let's see what we can do as far as that goes. The second thing I'll talk about that the board did that impacts hams is, let's say, sort of contest-related things. And how many of you use Logbook of the World? Slightly less than half. Well, Logbook of the World is a way of electronically having QSL cards. If you're interested in confirming the fact that you've talked to 100 countries or 50 states, you no longer have to exchange QSL cards through the mail with people and groups that like go on expeditions to rare countries don't get swamped with 20,000 paper QSLs that they have to answer, and you don't have to pay multiple dollars to send self-addressed stamped envelopes to other countries to get your card. So Logbook of the World has been very successful. Many people view it as one of the league's main contributors to amateur radio, and the board has supported it in interesting ways. It was first put together almost as a free edition by one of the paid staff. He kind of thought this might be a neat idea, and sort of on his spare time, I don't know, probably some of it when he was paid and some of it at night when he wasn't, he put together a version of it. And he was a very skilled programmer in it, served the purposes that were needed for a while. And then as it grew bigger and bigger, it had issues supporting the amount of volume of traffic that people were expecting out of it. And about 4 or 5 years ago, the board had a committee that looked at what can be done to make it better, and they made a bunch of suggestions. And the board at that point voted to fund 2 full-time staff people to be hired to work on Logbook of the World and improve it. So as I may have even covered that here last year or another year, the league hired the 2 people, and what happened? What kind of progress did they make? Well, they got taken off and put on other projects, and nothing happened. And with zero work on Logbook of the World, how did it improve? Well, it wasn't a self-improving program that improves itself by itself. It needed programmers, and nothing happened, and it stayed the same as it had been. Now, that's somewhat of an exaggeration. It was moved to better equipment so that it functions adequately when swamped with, like, the day after a DX contest or something like that. You'll have thousands of people uploading their logs for the contest and hoping that they'll get confirmations from the new countries that they talk to. And sometimes the system would slow down for a day because it couldn't absorb all that input. That was the hardware and software was upgraded to overcome that. And now after a big event like a DX contest or something, things slow down a little, but they pick up. And the user community understands that, and they, you know, don't expect their log to be uploaded in 2 seconds. It might take an hour or something like that. So that all works fine. Now, there are people on the board who kind of feel we need to even step up essentially what we call Logbook of the World to another level, and that's have it almost, let's say, be available so that people can upload contacts one at a time, and then somehow you can use Logbook of the World for judging contests as they take place. So you and I talk, and I upload my contact information, and you upload your contact information, and the computer automatically upgrades our scores. And if you have 20,000 people on the air, this is a pretty significant computer load. So I don't know whether this is going to be successful. I'm not even sure there's a demand for it. There obviously, if it existed, some people would use it, but I think the objective of those that want it is to deliver something that hams will use. And an item was budgeted to study this and actually hire a full-time staff person to, I guess, get the program started. So let's see whether anything comes of that. That's something that, again, that the board hopes will benefit some fraction of the ham radio operators. Let's just talk about another thing which wasn't actually part of the board meeting, but it was brought out that the Programs and Services Committee had changed some field day rules. And one of the things that I thought was sort of final was the field day formerly had, you got 2 points for CW contacts and 1 point for phone or RIDI or something to that effect, and the PSC has, I thought, had changed the rule so every contact was worth 1 point. And as I understand it, they're still going back and wondering whether that was a good rule or not. And just to go over some of the thoughts that have been put forth in discussions among directors and even other people are the concept that, well, field day isn't really a contest. It's a exhibit of emergency communications capability. Well, and then there are other people say, well, field day is, the main objective should be to have fun. And I thought about that long and hard just recently, and I don't know that we want to say field day is only something that we should go and have fun. I think we present an image to the public that some of us are serious about building our capability to operate in emergency situations, and field day gives us a chance to build those skills, and we want to say field day is a skill-building thing, and to have a competition emphasizes that. The other interesting point that in one of these discussions was brought to my attention was we report the results of field day in score order, and there are people who make lists of these are the record high score for three transmitter category in the Utah section or something like that. So, quote, it isn't a contest, but the fact that, well, maybe it's reported like it is. And if it wasn't a contest, why don't we report the results in call sign alphabetical order or by club name in alphabetical order or something like that? So, the contest part of field day encourage you to us to do our best to try to improve things, to do a little better than we would do if it weren't a competition. That's, again, my personal view. Does anyone have any comments on anything to do with field day? Thank you. Let's go on to the next thing.
You had a question over there, Dick.
Oh, we've got some.
Okay, winter field day. When's the league going to jump on that?
Well, there is a winter field day. Comment was, when is the league going to jump on the winter field day idea? And there is a winter field day. It's like, was it last week or it's around now?
Tomorrow.
It's tomorrow. So I can assure you it's not going to be a big hit in North Dakota and Minnesota this weekend, but unless they do the indoor part of it. But we all understand that for the most of the country, to have field day in the summer is the right answer. If you live in Arizona, well, maybe it isn't. And the concept of a winter field day strikes home. It's a really good idea as far as out here we might perceive. But it's happening. It's not put on by the league, I guess, but I believe it's as almost as successful as it would be. Are you suggesting that the league try to take over it? And,
well, no, but, you know, make it a league thing, too.
Make it a league thing was his suggestion. I thank you for the suggestion. I will consider it. We also have another director in the audience, Kristen McIntyre, K6WX, who is the representative of Northern California, Nevada, and Hawaii. So her vote on the board is exactly the same as mine. So if you...
I put this bug in her ear.
Well, you put... That's good. It's in her ear as well as mine. And any of you that have trouble convincing me of something, convince her of it, and she'll... it'll possibly go ahead. Well, did everyone hear that? Emergencies are, field day is preparation for emergencies, and emergencies don't only happen in great weather. So that's an interesting comment. Was there another field day comment? Let's go on to the next item. And there are three motions that passed the board that come out as a result of a committee that was put together to see what the league can do, I think, to increase on-the-air activity. And one of them is to the board authorized having a survey taken of hams to find out essentially why they're not active on the air. Now, I think that's a good thing to know. I'm not sure we need a board level motion. I think we could have just taken the survey. And the other comment I'll make on it is, I think I know why there are 700,000 licensed hams and only maybe a couple hundred thousand that are on the air. And we've discussed it at these forums before, and it's people aren't really interested in ham radio anymore. And just as you might have a difficulty in convincing me to do bowling again or something like that, or play bridge. I used to play bridge competitively. I haven't done that for many years, and the answer is I do something else. And there are people out there, believe it or not, who think they'd rather do something rather than sit down in a chair in front of a radio set with a Morse code key for 48 hours and without sleeping, like I think is fun. And as demented as those people may be, they probably are entitled to do whatever it is they prefer to do over the weekend. So let's see whether what comes up. Another thing we've discussed here is many people get licenses and really aren't interested in ham radio. And recently, in say the past 10 years, the situation is we have the cram courses where you go to a two-hour class on Saturday morning, and those who take the test afterwards have a 98% pass rate. And so, you know, some guy who's really interested in ham radio talks to his next-door neighbor and says, hey, you know, you want to come to the ham radio class and get a radio license? And he does, and 98% of the time he'll get a license. Does he have any interest? No. And the other point I keep bringing up is, like, the Los Angeles Airport Police, the boss of that group decided that all of policemen should get ham radio licenses, and about 200 of them took the exam. And how many of them do you think are active and are going to join the ARRL? Someone came up with the answer of two. I think he's high by two. I do think it's not a bad idea that these people understand ham radio is out there and exists, but I don't know that we're going to get them to be active on the air or get them to join the ARRL. The second thing the group got a motion through is to have what I'll call is a sort of a national level training program. And the idea is to have videos available for use to tell, to train people to become hams and train beginner level hams to operate and how to set stations up, how to put antennas up. And I think that's certainly an admirable thing. And I point out that many of the groups that license people do that already at a local level. And I'm not sure that it's totally important that it be done at a national level. There's many videos out there already on almost all the subjects. And I hope the ones that the league comes up with are in some way better. I think it's important that the league demonstrate that it does want the training to happen, and I believe that's a positive. It's a positive action on the league to go ahead with this.
I nominate Gordon West to make those.
You nominate Gordon West. Hi, Gordon. Gordon does the same thing, and I know when he had his classes, although there are many people who perceived him as a competitor to the ARRL, and in some sense he is, but I've pointed out that he actively promoted ARRL membership among all his graduates who passed the license exam. So I'm not sure that the league didn't actually benefit from the Gordon West Books and License School So I thank you for that, Gordon. And obviously you'll see that I'm not the only one doing so.
You're just glad Wayne Green's dead.
I'm not glad Wayne Green's dead. Wayne Green was an interesting cat, although that's about what I want to say about it.
One of the most important things for a new amateur is to know how to do things. It's covered so well in the ARRL operating manual. For new operators, for new licensees, and new members to the league, it should be included as part of the membership.
Just in case anyone didn't hear that, this gentleman pointed out that in his opinion, the league operating manual basically tells you what you need to do to set up and operate as a beginner, and he strongly suggested distributing that the operating manual to people who are new and joining the league. And the people here have heard your suggestion, and others will think about it. I thank you for making it.
Dick. So a comment on that. I think that's an important point, and it is valuable to have that manual. But I think one of the things the league needs to really do is come up to date with the new media. And so books are good and books are important. And I think our crowd, our older generation, that makes sense for. But to bring on the new generation, the next generation of hams, they're looking at digital media. They're looking at videos. They're looking at things to read online. And I think that's one of the things that I hope that you can help bring back to the league and help have them understand that in the publication world, it makes sense to continue to do that. But they need to branch out into the new technology.
Okay, let's review that for those who didn't hear it. It was pointed out that a lot of the younger generation consider digital media as the way to communicate information to them, and that the league should concentrate on that. And we understand that, and I think that's one of the major points of the topic I talked about, that we're going to do the training sort of on a national level. Yes, there was a compliment for the beginner magazine that the ARRL started, I don't know, 3 or 4 years ago, and has been quite a success. Actually, I think out of our 150-something thousand members, you can pick one of the magazines the league publishes as your magazine that's included with membership. You can pay for the others, and you get them all for free electronically on the web. But I think about 20,000 people have that as their primary a magazine, and that tells you it's popular.
Yeah, I was going to comment that I remember years ago there was a little pamphlet that ARRL used to pass out. It was a kind of general overview of how it operated and stuff. It wasn't as comprehensive as the book. The second thing is, if he wanted to just send out a magazine, it's something that
okay, there was two comments there. One was the league apparently had a publication a few years back that had sort of roughly what to do when you first were licensed. I'm not exactly sure what that is, because there have been a number of those. And then the other comment was, it's not only important to have written material available, but a one-on-one interaction with new hams, such as when clubs license people, they have you get your license. Okay, now we have a class on what's next. I know Gordon West even used to do that as well. And I think many of the clubs with big licensing programs have the same idea. We had a comment. We have like three comments.
Ditto what she said. When we give a class, we have to have a class. After that, says, yes, I have a license. Now what do I do? And you tell them where all the repeaters are, and you have to control them, where all the clubs are, where they can join, and make sure that they get assigned a mentor to keep them going. I mean, that's
right, we had that. That was another comment on the same line of another group that has, we have two here and one there. Let's go, Blue. Yes. I guess everyone heard that, but it was Dave Kasler, K-E-0-O-G, who I met here a few years ago and alerted me at that time to the fact that he had a website with hundreds of training videos already on it, and as he pointed out here, he has worked with the league, and they're all available already, and the ones I've looked at, I feel are good, and I'm happy that the league now is working with Dave and that he's writing a monthly QST article, a column as well. We had a comment here.
Vegas, if we run a new camp, and we have to have a
That was a comment that basically said another way of assisting new hams was through a, say, a once-a-week repeater, beginner net that experienced hams guide beginners and answer questions that they bring up at the on the air meetings. We had a comment back here.
Dick, I've been hanging around this hobby since 1960, and an ARRL. I look at this whole situation as like baking a cake. Our hobby is very diversified. It's wide open. Baking a cake requires different ingredients in that cake. And I find Dave Kasler's videos, like I say, I've been in the hobby since 1960. If I need to know something about a new radio, I go to Kasler's. Or somebody else, it's a combination of what we see digitally. It's a combination of what we see written. And if we're not mentoring, we're missing the boat. I mentor a lot of new hams with what we might call a two-day wonder. They can't solder, they can't twist two wires together. And what our clubs and organizations need to be doing is presenting hands-on activities.
resistor in a circuit. It's a combination of all of these things and an effort from all of us to do it. And it's easy to sit, and I've seen it happen in clubs I belong to sit and talk about it, but we've got to take action and we've got to step up and help these folks. And like I say, they don't know squat. They passed the test. That's all they know.
Okay, that was a comment that basically, those that didn't hear it, basically emphasized the importance of mentoring, and both pointed out that it benefited him in his earlier days, and he is now participating and believes that it is one-on-one mentoring is an important thing for getting people started in amateur radio. Okay, Rick. Organizations are requiring people to get ham radio licenses or at least learn about ham radio, and it has, among other facts, the essentially training on how to get over the idea of mic fright, because when you pick up a microphone when you're newly licensed, you don't know what to say, you don't know how to interact with people on the air, and ham radio provides that background. There was one more comment.
Yeah, the league used to put out all these PSAs in the 50s, 60s, and early 70s about amateur radio stuff. In 1965, I was an 11-year-old kid in Guam, and we have AFRTS over there. There's no commercial, but it's all PSAs where the commercials go. And one of those PSAs was a strawberry blonde with a sports car. I can't remember the car, I can't remember the rig, but I remember her.
Well, there was what appears to be a suggestion that the league somehow find a strawberry blonde in a sports car to publicize ham radio or some feature of improving our capabilities.
They used to be on TV.
There was one point when hams had public service announcements that went over television channels that they would play for us in the middle of the night when they didn't have any advertisers. I don't know to what extent we would benefit by trying to produce some of these things and distribute them. They don't exist anymore, and I assume that...
Well, they're on the internet.
They're on the internet is the issue, that people can watch them whenever they'd like. We had, again, two more comments.
Every morning, 9 o'clock California time, we have a net on the W6REK Echo Link node with the sole intention of making information available to new hams and letting them know what's going on in the area. Anybody can listen. Anybody can check in. We have a person in Arizona that even runs the net at net control time to time.
Okay, that was another example of how to communicate to beginners over an IRLP W6REK operation that takes place regularly. There was one more comment in the back.
More on air, I mean radio, TV, information about the hobby.
that was an example of someone who basically, because of an Elmer, is now an active ham and actually quite active, and it wouldn't have happened without the Elmer, and perceives that we really need more exposure of our activity to the public. We try as much as we can. Way back there in okay, that was another suggestion that the league go back into publishing the public service announcement videos and make them available to TV stations. And we need a muffler improvement program for quartz last year. But again,
like our club field day, we used to have KQED or KTEH, whatever translator they paid it on in the Bay Area, the public service announcement would go out the day before field day and on the first day of Tuesday.
Right, that was in the Bay Area, the public PBS public broadcast stations would broadcast their one club's upcoming field days. And a lot of you that have clubs active in field days do publicize them in with the TV stations in some parts of the country, radio stations and others, and local publications as well. Okay, let's go back to the third item that the get on the air improvement suggestions were made, was to somehow have the league promote the fact that 10 and 6 meters is open, and that should get people interested in ham radio. There are existing contests that take place on 10 meters. There is existing contests that take place on 6 meters. I don't know exactly that something we can do to make people who aren't interested in getting on the air at all somehow get active enough to participate in those. We do encourage activity. I live in a small community in California with probably maybe the highest percentage of licensed hams to population anywhere, but all the people got licensed because of emergency communications. And out of, I don't know, 200 licensees in a population of 6,000 or 7,000 people, Topanga, California, we have maybe 5 of them have become, I'll call, active hams that you kind of perceive as hams. The others kind of have radios that they want to use as cell phones when the cell phones don't work. But even with all these people, I have a reasonably decent station, and I invite those who participate in field day to come up and play in a DX contest or whatever. And I had, I think, one time one person take me up on it. They're just interested in other things. Maybe they go bowling. I don't know. So let's see how that works out. Another thing the board does is, I'll call it housekeeping. And there's an important part of that goes on that I will comment on, and that is, in the last year or so, the league has transitioned over from having its investments managed by a treasurer who picks stocks and bonds and buys them individually or buys mutual funds, to now we have a paid investment manager, and the company is called Cap Trust. It's in North Carolina. It's a highly rated firm, and we have a new league treasurer who has many years of experience in managing large amounts of money, and his report to us, and I take it as being valid and something we should believe, is he believes we're better off having this professional manager than we would have otherwise. Now, all stocks and bonds went down last year, and so did the league lose money? Yeah. Did it lose as much as the averages? No, we did a little better. We still have something like $34 million in the bank, and we're not going out of business. Again, 12 years ago, we had $6 or $8 million in the bank. And those numbers, you can look at the ARRL annual reports to validate the numbers I'm giving you. So we're in fine shape financially. And we have an interesting way of keeping the books through the year where we either, quote, make money or lose money. And it's important to try to at least balance things out and not lose money year after year. But we could lose $1 million a year for 34 years, and we'd be in existence. And I'm going to tell you, in 34 years, if I'm around and we're going out of business, I'll be happy. I also have the feeling that for the most part, the league is primarily a membership organization, and we should be supporting it. If we think we need a national organization, those of us that are members should be putting enough money into it that it runs itself. I'm pleased with the choice we've made in terms of what we're doing with our money, and I think that the board is serving you well by the decisions that it made. Let's go on to the next topic, and that's the board's concerns with the board. And there's been a number of them, those going on. Most, what I'll bring up is the first motion that passed, and you read the motion in detail when it comes out in the minutes, is the board basically is forming a committee to study putting together a new, quote, code of conduct. Now, those of you that were involved with code of conducts a few years ago, maybe it didn't work out to benefit the league, but anyhow, the new board passed a motion to do that. It also passed a motion to have a group work out rules for what's called the Ethics and Elections Committee. Now, let's discuss that in a little detail. Every organization has the potential of having conflicts of interest. And say for about the first 90 years or so of ARRL existence, any of those conflict of interest questions were handled by the board itself. Somebody would go to the board and say, I'm going to build microphones and sell them at a profit. Is that a conflict of interest? And the board would kind of look over and say, yeah, maybe it is. Maybe you shouldn't be on the board, or you should do some recusal of not participating in board discussions when the board votes to have an official ARRL microphone or something to that effect. At some point, I don't know, maybe 20 years ago or so, 25 years ago, the board offloaded that responsibility to a committee called Ethics and Elections Committee, and it was responsible for receiving complaints or questions about ethics or elections issues and making rulings on them. And then if the rulings were in any way disputed, the entire issue could go to the full board, which would then include it. And I'm still up to the concept of having a muffler noise reduction program funded here. I hope that doesn't override me too much. So what's happened now is the Elections and Ethics Committee has gone along successfully for maybe 20 years, and this year has had some issues with things that it's done, and now we have a group who would, I guess, want clear boxes that it can check off, and then when you check the boxes off, the answer of what you should do automatically falls out of the bottom of the machine. I don't believe that all issues in life are like that. Some of them you kind of have to listen to two sides of an issue and then, you know, use your judgment and your experience in life and come up with an answer. And I think we've done that, and I'm not certain that adding structure to our bureaucracy is an important part of what the board does, but it has done that. Any comments on any of those board concerns with the board issues? Okay, let's see what else we have here. This will be a kind of one of the more controversial issues we'll talk about today, and it's radio politics. And in the past, I've described the board as having two factions, and I'll say one of them is the transparency group, and the other is the confidentiality group. And right now, the confidentiality party has a strong majority. It's either 11 to 4 or 9 to 6. So it's that's how things are today. And I'm in the transparency minority, and I explain myself. And those of you that are in the Southwestern Division decide whether you should vote for me next time, or if somebody better comes along, you might vote for him. I'll describe the board in two other ways, but the definition of, split of which members are members of which party or whatever are kind of the same. And if you want to see whether somebody's a member of one side or another, all you have to do is look at the minutes and of roll call votes on controversial issues, and you'll see some people will be voting this way and others vote that way, and it's pretty consistent. You'll see the same people vote one side of an issue as they will the other. So there's two other differentiations between the board members as far as how they view things. And one of them I'll say is, how do you view the league? Is the league has an interesting financial structure. It's, to me, in my mind, it's basically a membership organization. Members pay dues. They expect the league to deliver to them some kind of product or service or whatever. And I'm sure many of you realize that there's a substantial group out there who thinks of league membership as a QST subscription. And that's, to them, that's what the league does. The league happens to be organized as a nonprofit corporation, and it's in Connecticut. And what that means is it doesn't make money and distribute the profit back to stockholders or shareholders. And so I'm not sure whether that's very important in the minds of anyone here. But again, if you want to make contributions to the league has to be a nonprofit organization. And it is. So to me, I'd say the board is divided up into some who think the league is mainly a membership organization that's responsible to deliver product, and the other is that it's a nonprofit corporation, and the most important thing is the corporation itself. And if you read books and instructions about nonprofit corporations, protecting the corporation is very important. So I'll say, in terms of the transparency confidentiality split on the board, there are the confidentiality folks don't want anything discussed that it would in any way sour people on, say, donating money or supporting the league or being members of the league. And I'll say the transparency people are more into telling what goes on, and if there's anything wrong with the league, we correct it, and then you're happy with the final result. So again, that's the second differentiation. The third is, I'll put it in to be blunt, is some of the board is very happy with the new chief executive officer, and some of the rest of us are unhappy. So 2.5 years ago, the league selected a new CEO. I didn't vote for him at the time. I thought there were other people who would have been a better choice. I was outvoted. I was originally optimistic that he'd work out to be just fine. Make no doubt about it. He is enthusiastic about ham radio. He wants to do well. But in the end, as we've come 2.5 years down the road, I'm not particularly pleased with the way things have worked out. And I'll go over some of the issues I happen to have with him. He's responsible for the staff, and there's been a substantial change in the staff in great measure due to the CEO himself. Now, I will say, lately he's hired some people who I both think have performed well, and other new ones who I expect to perform well, and so that's kind of something that I have to consider when I worry about this. The second thing is, digitally, the League communicates with membership by electronically by the website, and we had a new, I'll call it, membership financial system implemented a few months ago, called put together by a company called Personify, and when we implemented that, the League website went down for a week. There were all kinds of complaints from members about various things, and I'm unhappy that when you put a new a system in, that the users suffer. The way a system should go in is you test the system offline in parallel with your regular system. Then when they're both working adequately, then you switch over and maybe you have a couple of little bugs to fix. The last bug I got reported by a member was he made a reasonably sized donation to the League and got an acknowledgement by email, "Thank you for your purchase." Well, that shouldn't go out, and I'm unhappy with management allowing that level of, miscommunication with members. When you make a donation to the League of a certain amount, you will get an acknowledgement letter that you can use to validate your deductions that you use on your income tax statement from the IRS. The League will do that, but just the concept that you send somebody a letter, thanks for your purchase, doesn't really, isn't how an operation should take place. Secondly, another thing is, I'm unhappy to read editorials in QST where the editorials criticize certain factions of hams, in particular those who pay attention to the politics of the League and comment on it. I also don't believe that giving speeches that badmouth groups of hams as well is appropriate at the ARRL management level, and so I'm unhappy there. And lately, something has come up that I have a hard time even saying this, but for the first time, this is my 19th year on the board, when I've asked for financial information from management about some kind of issue that went on, I get it, and I get it immediately. This time, it appears that something I considered was an important financial request has been denied. I asked for the information before the board meeting. It wasn't given to me before the board meeting. I did get an email that said, "We'll be getting it back to you." Here we are a week after the board meeting, and I still haven't received it. And it's very simple information, so I'm very displeased with that. And the membership now knows it. Incidentally, the board knows it as well, and they also knew that that I thought it was important. And no other members of the board spoke up in terms of suggesting that the information be given to me, and they know exactly what it is. So that's it. Another issue is salary of people. When I started in ham radio, the ARRL was kind of an organization, but it was a membership organization where volunteers did a lot of the work. And it is today. We've got, I don't know, section managers, there's at least three of them here, probably more. There's directors, there's other volunteers that have worked for the league. And those who worked in paid positions in Newington were paid less than they could make in the outside world. It was always understood by the board that Dave Sumner, when he ran the league, could have tripled his salary by going to Washington and working for ComSat or AT&T and being on these committees that go over to Europe and argue high level telecommunications issues. He worked for less, and now we're in a different situation. Basically, people are sort of paid on we have to match salaries in the outside world, and that makes it financially tough on those who are supporting it. So I'm in favor of more of the half volunteer employee as opposed to the employee who has a job and then went through the 2-hour licensing course and has a call sign and really is never on the air. I think dedication to our cause is an important feature for many of our employees. We have a good number of them that fall into that category, there are positions that hams should be in that are not, and I'm not particularly pleased with that. So that's some comments I have on sort of political issues. Does anyone have any comments, criticisms, other points of view on that?
The guy that's in charge of doing the stuff about the HOAs to Congress, why does that always get introduced in October and November, just before the new people come in and it dies? This has been going on since
a show about that.
The comment was, why does the guy who gets bills introduced in Congress get them introduced in October when nothing can be done about them? In all honesty, I would say that's when he got a guy to sign on. Now, whether or not the congressman signed on had his approval at that point where it was obvious that he couldn't do anything, that would imply that was the reason for it, I'm not certain. But I believe that the fellow that is responsible for that program thinks he can have something happen. As I've spoken to this group before, we've been doing this for 30 years. And if you think we're going to get a legislation through that says if you signed a contract that you weren't going to do something in your homeowners association, that we can get Congress to override it, I'd like to see it happen, because I'm a radio ham and I think ham radio is good, but I don't honestly think we will. But it doesn't hurt me to try. And I'd say the guy that got the congressman to introduce this bill did as good as he can, and he thinks it's going to be reintroduced, and it probably will. And remember, we've been here before. We've got bills that have kind of gone on, and we'll get reports. Hey, I got XYZ congressman to sign on, and he's going to be a co-sponsor, and I've got ABC senator, he's going to support it. And in the end, it hasn't passed. So Arizona has the ultimate example of that. I know it was about 10 or 12 years ago, the Arizona lower house passed an anti-homeowners association bill, and then one senator held it up, and at that time the governor was well known by actually the then section manager, and she agreed she would have signed it had it been passed, but it never got passed. And that's Arizona, and we haven't succeeded in any of the other 49 states either. So I'd like to see it pass. They're doing their best. Any more comments on homeowners associations or anything like that? Okay, anything, is there anything that any of you would like discussed in more detail, or anything you'd like to bring up or suggest? Rick Paquette has talked about the, quote, volunteers on the air program that's taking place. It's to emphasize the fact that there are volunteers that contribute to the ARRL organization and try to make it function. And and the league has this on-the-air program by contacting us. You can work your way up to have some higher level of recognition in another, quote, sort of long-term contest. And I'm probably worth more points than Rick is, although he's probably more contributor to ham radio than I might be. He's a really hard worker, as any of you know, in Arizona. And Arizona has had the last several section managers I've worked with has a very difficult job, because you have so many ham fests. There's more than one a month, and they're far away. I mean, they're hundreds of miles away, and he's at all, essentially all of them. I would come to them, but I have the excuse that, you know, driving 500 miles each way is not necessarily a good use of my time or funds. So that's that. There was something else that I wanted to bring up with respect to section managers. That's another thing. The board passed a resolution, passed a motion that kind of talks about the relationship between section managers and the ARRL board. And there was originally some kind of attempt by some to get section managers to report to the directors, and I was opposed to that. As far as I'm concerned, section managers are elected by the population of their section, and they should be accountable to those members, not to me. You elect me as the director of the division. I am accountable to you, and I owe my position to you. I should do something to make you appreciate and vote for me. So the ends up that the motion that got passed ends is something to the effect of essentially section managers are accountable to the ARRL board and headquarters, whatever that means. So it's there. Again, I appreciate section managers. I don't tell them what to do. I think all the section managers, and there's three of the Southwestern Division section managers here, I appreciate the fact that all of you are participating in the job. And the job of the section manager is in some sense harder, because it's his job to get volunteers to do stuff. It's, you know, my job is to go to meetings and try to convince other board members to do stuff. That's probably easier than getting volunteers to give their time and effort. And some of the things that ham radio does require substantial effort and outlay of essentially funds by volunteers. So that's another thing. Any other subjects that we should cover? Once again, I thank you for your attendance. Have a good day.
Thank you, Dick. And Dick's here all the way from Los Angeles. If you're an AWO representative, would you raise your hand? Thanks a lot for being here and supporting us.